Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Biomystery. I am Andrea Bonig and today I am back with a new topic, that is virus. Now virus, unlike other microorganisms, they are non-cellular in nature. That means they do not have their own machinery, ribosomes, or you can say a nucleus to synthesize its proteins and DNA. So they are non-living when they are outside the host cell. So it requires a host cell into which it will enter and it will start synthesizing its own proteins and DNA utilizing the host's enzyme and proteins. So in other words, we can say that virus become living when they enter into a host cell and starts infecting the host cell. So they are non-cellular, non-living, although they are very, very dangerous. They are very small. Their size ranges from 20 nanometer to 300 nanometer, sometimes 1000 nanometer as well. So they are so small that viruses can be filtered easily. Okay, once the virus enters into the host cell, it possesses the machinery of the host cell and starts multiplying its number. So virus actually is a Latin name. This is a Latin name, which means poison. It is actually a poison. It can infect a plant, it can infect an animal, a human being. Like in human beings, common cold, very common, that is caused by virus. Hepatitis, caused by virus. There are certain cancers which are caused by viruses as well. So this term virus was coined by Martinus W. Benjrick. And another scientist was there, who is Stanley. Wendell Stanley. And he discovered that virus contain nucleic acid and proteins. So he is the one who discovered that viruses contain nucleic acid, that is DNA or RNA. So if we look at the characteristics of the virus, they are non-cellular, they are non-living, they contain genetic materials like DNA, RNA. Non-cellular, non-living. They are also obligate intracellular parasites. Why obligate? Because they, for them to be infectious, they need a host cell. It's very compulsory for viruses to get a host cell into which it will enter and it will utilize the host cell's machinery to synthesize its proteins and DNA so that it can multiply in number and infect the cell or the organism. So that's why. So they are non-living when they are outside. So they do not respond to any stimuli. So they do not respond to stimuli. They contain DNA or RNA, but they will not contain both. They will contain either DNA or RNA. Now that DNA can be double strand DNA, single strand DNA, double strand RNA, single strand RNA, that we will see. This virus, this DNA or the nucleic acid, they are covered, they are protected by a coating, and that coating is a protein coat, which is called capsid. So this DNA or RNA, it is protected by a covering, which is called capsid. It is a protein coat. Okay, some viruses, they may have envelope or another covering which protects the capsid. Some viruses, they may have envelope. This envelope is it is made up of lipids, proteins, carbohydrates. We can say lipoprotein envelope. So it protects the capsid. Example of a virus which has envelope is influenza virus. It can have envelope. Clear? So these are few characteristics or an introduction of virus. What is it? How it looks like? Okay? And when it infects the host cell, it multiplies inside the host cell, and this then undergoes two cycles. One is lytic cycle, another is lysogenic cycle. So when it multiplies, it can occur in two ways. It can multiply in two ways. Lytic cycle, when the host virus particle is multiplying inside the host, and then it causes lysis of the host cell and spreads the infection and spreads all the virion particles. What is virion particle? This is the virus particle which is a completely coated with capsid and contains nucleic acid, and it causes infection. So when the virus particle becomes infectious, then that is called virion. Okay? And for lysogenic cycle, the virus, the DNA of the virus integrates into the host cell chromosome and it stays in that form unless it is activated. So when the virus enters into the host cell, when the nucleic acid rather enters into the host cell, the DNA or RNA gets integrated into the chromosome of the host cell, and that forms a prophage, and that remains like that unless it is activated. Once it is activated, it causes lysis. It spreads. So this is an overview of characteristics of virus. Next, we will see the structure of virus. Next is structure of virus. It has nucleic acid. This can have DNA and RNA. This DNA can be double-stranded, single-stranded. RNA can also be double-stranded, single-stranded. But under single-stranded, it is also positive strand, negative strand. Under single strand as well, there is RNA which is converted to DNA. RNA converted to DNA using the enzyme retrotranscriptase. This type of the virus which contains this type of RNA, they causes cancer. We also have DNA, double stranded DNA, which uses reverse transcriptase enzyme. Clear? We will see this classification. Next, the capsid is present. This what is capsid? It covers, or it we can say protects the DNA or RNA. It is a protein covering. It is made up of protein. Okay? In some, and one more thing about this capsid, depending on the structure of capsid, viruses can be classified into three. One is complex virus, one is polyhedral virus, one is helical virus. That we will see with examples. Another thing is envelope. Envelope is also present in few viruses like influenza. This envelope mainly made up of lipid, protein, which we call lipoprotein. Sometimes carbohydrates may be present. Glycoproteins can be present in the envelope. So this is an overall structure of virus. Now, this envelope, sometimes they contain spikes. And these spikes helps the virus to attach to the surface of the host cell. Okay? Now, when the virus infects a host cell, the host cell starts producing antibodies against that virus. And this interaction between the host cell antibodies and the virus, it destroys the virus particles. But in some cases, few viruses are there who changes or whose capsid, a genes of capsid, some portion of the gene of this capsid covering is mutated. It mutates some portion of the gene of the protein covering. Thus, the host cell cannot recognize that portion. The memory, suppose a virus has already infected that organism beforehand. Okay, so that organism has produced antibodies against that virus and memory T cells, B cells are present. Now, again, when that infection has come back, at that time, that virus has mutated in some portion of the capsid. Some genes of the capsid is mutated. So the memory T cell B cells cannot recognize that portion. So the infection can recur again. In case of influenza, it starts recurring. So one can get influenza more than once due to the mutation that occurs in the genes of the capsid, in some portion of the capsid. Clear? So this is an overview of the introduction or the structure of virus. Next, we will see how viruses can be classified based on this capsid structure. So, based on the structure of capsid, the virus can be classified into three. One is helical virus. One is polyhedral virus. One is complex virus. Now, this helical virus, I'm trying to draw actually, this is a schematic diagram. Please excuse me. I'm not good at drawing. So actually, the shape is like helical. The capsid shape is like helical in structure. So this is helical in structure. The capsid is helical, and inside this capsid, the nucleic acid is present. And the small units that you can see here, this is called capsomere units. So these capsomere units is making up this, what is helical structure. Example of this helical virus, that means virus which are possessing this helical like capsid, is Ebola virus is there. We have rabies virus. Now, for polyhedral, this is just a schematic diagram. There is a beautiful diagram given in your book. You can check it. Just to make you understand what is this polyhedral virus, this contains icosahedral structure. That means it contains 20 triangular faces. So that's why I've tried to draw these triangles. So there are 20 such triangular faces and 12 vertices, or we can say 12 ends are there. There are 12 such ends. Okay, this is called icosahedral structure. Example of this kind of virus is polio virus is there, which has capsid whose shape is like this. We have herpes virus, okay. Next, complex virus. Complex means it possesses both icosahedral structure as well as this helical structure. So its structure is somewhat complicated. So if I try to draw this, so it contains a head. Okay, so this is the head of this virus. There is this tail. This tail is helical shape. And this is the base plate to which pins are attached. And we have tail fibers. Okay. If I label this, this is the head. Okay. This portion is the tail. This portion is the tail sheet. These are tail fibers, and with the help of this tail fiber, it attaches to the host cell. So there is a weak bonds that are formed between these tail fibers and the cell membrane of the host cell. There are pins as well. This red one I'm drawing, these are pins, which are also present. This is the base plate. This is the base plate. And these are pins. So this is an schematic diagram I've tried to draw. So this is the complex virus, who has a head, a tail sheet is there, this tail fiber is there, base plate is there, and pins are there. Example of a virus which poses this kind of capsid is you have pox virus. Example is pox virus. Bacteriophage is there. Okay. What is bacteriophage? The virus which infects bacteria. That is bacteriophage. So this is an introduction, or we can say this is the structure or classification of virus based on the capsid structure. Next, we are going to see some other classification based on the nucleic acid. We have seen that some viruses, they possess envelope which surrounds the capsid. We will also see the nucleic acid virus which contains envelope, which do not contain any envelope. So we will classify this virus, and this type of classification is called Baltimore classification. So let's see the classification of virus based on the nucleic acid particles, that is DNA and RNA. So we will do the Baltimore classification, which is founded by David Baltimore. Okay. Based on this classification, viruses can be classified into DNA virus, RNA virus. DNA can be double-stranded, single-stranded. RNA can be double-stranded, single-stranded. So let's see. So if I classify the DNA virus first, it has double-strand DNA. It has single-strand DNA. Again, we can also classify double strand as non-enveloped, enveloped. That means those virus which possess the envelope, that is, they also contain double strand DNA. Non-enveloped may also contain double strand DNA. Now, example of non-enveloped double strand DNA is, we have adenovirus, papillomavirus. I'm writing the general name, I'm not writing the family name. If family name ends with viridae, okay, if I write the name of the family for a particular virus, its name will end as day, viridae. For viruses which are enveloped and contains double strand DNA, and that is pox virus, simplex virus, there is also varicellus, cellovirus. Okay? So there are many examples. Now, single strand DNA, they are only non-enveloped only. They do not contain any enveloped virus. So they are non-enveloped, and example of such virus is human parvovirus B19. You just have to remember few examples, because there are various examples which is very difficult to memorize. So we can just memorize few of them. This is about the virus whose nucleic acid is composed of DNA, the double strand, single strand, envelope, non-envelope. Now let's see the virus whose nucleic acid is RNA. RNA virus. There can be double strand RNA. There can be single strand positive RNA. Positive RNA means this RNA is identical to the viral mRNA. So this RNA can be directly translated to proteins. On the other hand, there is also single strand negative RNA. That means this RNA is complementary to the viral mRNA, and this is first converted to positive mRNA, and then it can be translated into proteins. Next, we have RNA which forms DNA. Okay? Now, this single strand RNA, positive one, it has again subclassification, which is non-enveloped and enveloped. But for negative one, it is only non-enveloped. Clear? Now, sorry, it is enveloped. Now, example of this double strand RNA is reovirus, rotavirus. These are responsible for infection in the respiratory tract. For single strand positive RNA which are non-enveloped, example is enterovirus, hepatitis A, E virus. I'm writing only the general name. I'm not writing the family name, okay? Otherwise, this falls into different family. This falls into different family. For enveloped one, we have very famous coronavirus. We have hepatitis C virus, rubella virus is there. Clear? For RNA containing single strand negative and enveloped, for this they have influenza virus, A, B, C, Hunter virus, rhabdovirus. For this one, it is enveloped. Remember this. This is enveloped. And example is, you have lentivirus. You have retrovirus. Because this uses the enzyme retrotranscriptase. And the RNA is converted to DNA, and this causes the cancer. So mainly all cancer which are caused by viruses, it is mainly due to this, due to that kind of RNA which is present in the virus, which uses reverse transcriptase converting to DNA. Clear? There is another classification as well, that is double strand DNA, which utilizes the reverse transcriptase enzyme. And that example of this hepatitis B virus, that is Haptavirus, that utilizes the DNA that is present, utilizes the reverse transcriptase enzyme. So this is overall an overview of the classification of virus based on the nucleic acid content and the classification of the virus based on the capsid structure. In the next video, I'm going to discuss about the multiplication of virus that takes place inside the host cell using the lysogenic cycle and lytic cycle, and how viruses causes cancer, the oncogenic virus. So thank you.